place. Similar to the present, voices in the media push a narrative. A local paper, the News and Observer, incited whites to overthrow black elected officials. And because 25% of whites were illiterate, it wasn't always with words. Then how they utilize art, political cartoons, to carry the day.
Right. This was all part of the disinformation and the big lie in North Carolina at that time. One of them had a picture of a black man that looked like a claw reaching out and grasping, fleeing white man. I mean, it was just horrible that it had a very incendiary effect on white voters. They just pushed all their buttons about the insecurities they already had.
But Editor Alexander Manley pushed back in his daily press.
In August of 1898, when he wrote an editorial saying that most of the black men who were lynched for allegedly raping white women were in fact their consensual lovers. And he also pointed out that for generations, white men had been raping black women with impunity.
3 months after Manley's editorial ran, and 2 days after the election, a mob of armed white citizens led by former Confederate officer Alfred Moore Waddell set the paper ablaze and forced out Wilmington's mayor and city council. 60 black men were killed in the streets that day, and black voting rights were limited for more than 7 decades. Some of those same techniques used in 1898 remain in the political arena today.
Did you see the tea leaves in the election of 2016?
Oh, yeah. When he came down that escalator to announce his run, he talked about Mexican racism. He used that word coming across the border.
They're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists.
To steal American jobs. And that is the same message that the white supremacists used.
We had an election that was stolen from us.
The big lie to the disinformation that if you repeat the lie often enough, and loudly enough, people will believe it, and all of that, they will act on it.
So the legacy here, the lesson.
The lesson is that there is power in disinformation, there is power in lies, and that it is quite easy for a skilled demagogue like President Trump and like the leaders of the white supremacy movement to incite people based on their fears and grievances.
Do you have any hope we can move beyond this?
Well, people like Stacey Abrams and women in Georgia who worked so hard to fight voter suppression gives me great hope. In this country, there is that deep, deep undercurrent hatred among whites and fears and grievances who feel that they have no choice but to use violence to take back what they think is their country. And that worries me a lot.
The lasting impact, consider this, in 1896, 2 years before the coup, there were 126,000 black men registered to vote. 4 years after that, 125,000, my eyesight's going, in North Carolina, I should say. 4 years after the coup in 1902, that number had whittled down to just 6,100, and it went down from there. There wasn't an African-American voted into the State House of North Carolina until 1969, into Congress until the 1970s, and in Wilmington, they didn't see it until 1972.
Seemed so progressive before, and then what was it all changed?
If you don't learn from the past, you will repeat it.
Your eyesight may be going, but you bring the history lesson.
Yeah.